Ladies, gentlemen, fellas, welcome in to the Week 7 Final Thoughts Show. Now, before we get the schmacks in, just remember this is going to be injury news, of course. So if somebody in this video ends up getting ruled out of nowhere, COVID things pop up, whatever it is, I didn't cover it because of that. But we still have the Sunday live stream to get your final schmacks in, the Sunday Patreon stuff. So let's get in these final thoughts. Position by position, I have my projections done, my ownership projections done. Obviously, these will be updated based on news as we get closer to lock. Rankings, the matchup notes. We are ready. We are loaded. We got our backpack on. Our holsters are loaded. We're ready to go to war in the DFS, the prop bet, and the betting streets this week. All I ask from you is subscribe button. There it is. If you got 2 seconds to double check and make sure and ensure that you have secured the subscribe button. So with that, let's slide in now to the quarterback position. Week 7 is just 10 games, and it's 10 games where you actually have a lot of really good quarterbacks on the slate, actually, for us, right? You have Mahomes, Stafford, Murray, Brady, Rodgers, Lamar Jackson, even Jalen Hurts is a fantasy lovely, lovely play. As always, he has been right now a top 5 quarterback so far. But this week, as you could see if you're watching on the YouTube version, I only have 2 yeses, which in most weeks it's 3 to 5. I only have 2 right now. Now, I do have some tiers to this. I have my tier 1s of quarterbacks, which is these 2 yeses in Patrick Mahomes and Matthew Stafford. I would rank a tier 2 as a Kyler Murray and Tom Brady. And then I would rank the tier 3 as the remaining players in this list, which would be Aaron Rodgers, Lamar Jackson, Jalen Hurts, and Derek Carr. And as always, I'm making these videos for GPP purposes. If you are a strictly cash game player, well then yes, you could probably bump up Jalen Hurts and Lamar Jackson into that yes category. But if we're just looking at our yeses right now, and we could start there, you want to look at Patrick Mahomes. He has the highest total on the slate. Now, his team total is not the highest. There is 3 teams with a 30 or more higher implied team total. Mahomes is one of those, but the nice thing that he has is his opponent has the highest total for somebody who is actually an underdog this week. A 26 team implied total for Tennessee means that they have a better chance to fuel a higher shootout here. And not only a higher shootout, but also a floor to what could potentially be, maybe they don't go over, but they're still hitting the total of 54 instead of 56.5. And Mahomes is going to have a good matchup. I mean, this pass rush for Tennessee ranks 25th right now in the NFL. And you're going to be getting a top 10 offensive line for Mahomes coming into this week. You have Mahomes so far basically has a floor of 25 points. You saw the 25 points last week, right? You have so far this year 2 30-plus point performances, and in those games, he's doing it against matchups where there is a 50 implied total like he had against Cleveland and like he had against Philadelphia. Really, the only time Mahomes has let you down is on a showdown slate, which you didn't have to worry about playing him and stacking him up on a main slate with a lot of exposure. But on a showdown slate where it was rainy against the good Bills defense, and he loses Clyde Edwards-Helaire, he loses Tyreek Hill, and he loses Travis Kelce. So obviously we can't blame him. And he still scored 21 points. We can't blame him that much. And that's like the absolute rock bottom floor. Lose your top three weapons against a good defense in the rain. And that's what happens. That's your absolute worst case scenario floor. So that's why I like Mahomes. Obviously the stacking reasons are there. I think that there are two stacks way better than any other stack this week. And this is not me just saying I have a hunch. This is me actually running the data and seeing the amount of times that these stacks work out for you and are the winning stack. The first one is the Chiefs that we just talked about. The second one is the homecoming king going home against Detroit. Now, but they're 15-point favorites. There's no way. Last week they were what? 11-point favorites. We said to take the 10.5 when you can get it, take the 10. And then when Daniel Jones was ruled in over Mike Glennon, moved down to like 9 or 8.5. And what happens? They dominate. Yeah, Daryl Henderson in the running game gets there, but also Matthew Stafford gets there for throwing for multiple touchdown passes. Cooper Kupp goes off again. Robert Woods finds the end zone. Daryl Henderson himself finds the end zone. 4 touchdown game. As you know, Stafford averaging over 24 fantasy points per game. And oh yeah, this week he has the highest total. Yes, he is a 14.5-point favorite with the highest total on the slate. If they're going to be getting up in this game and scoring 35 points and winning by 14 to 15, I think that they can do some things in the passing game, right? For a guy who so far this season has over 305 passing yards per game. According to my matchup notes on Patreon, Matthew Stafford has a positive 20% pass blocking advantage in this one, as the Detroit Lions only generate a 26% pass rush, and they rank 32nd in coverage and 32nd in total defense. Matthew Stafford for me ranks out as a fantastic play. I have him for about 24 fantasy points. I have him coming in for about 10% ownership right now, which is completely fine to me. The second you stack it up, it starts to look a lot better. And now these other quarterbacks on here are solid options. Another massive favorite in Kyler Murray in this matchup. Kyler Murray against Houston. If you're going for GPPs, Kyler Murray probably comes in with a little bit less ownership here. I only have Kyler Murray as of right now coming in with 6% ownership, even though he's going to have a positive 24% advantage against a defense that ranks 27th overall, and they are bottom 10 in the league, and not just pass rush, but also coverage grades. So the 32 to 33 attempts per game you're getting out of Kyler Murray looks nice. It's going to be interesting, though, now, because we don't know exactly where we can find secure pieces in this offense. Yeah, Rondale Moore's price point's down to $4,400, and he looked great last week, but last week they didn't have the tight end. Zach Ertz wasn't on this team. looking at. Max Williams was hurt, so they played a lot more four wide receiver sets. Now that you're going to be putting a tight end back in the mix in Zach Ertz, a veteran who is a solid pass catcher, it's going to take a wide receiver off the field more often, meaning that Rondell Moore and Christian Kirk become less reliable when they rotate in for each other, meaning that AJ Green, when he's probably not scoring touchdowns, is not going to be reliable. And oh yeah, DeAndre Hopkins is still playing banged up and only has a 19% target share as a stud alpha receiver. So the problem for me with Kyler Murray, and I assume a lot of people as to why he's only 6% owned, is it's tough to really understand where the usage is going to come from. Now, the other guy who can potentially come a yes for me, it's going to be Tom Brady, just because he's record chasing, just because he has a 44, or he's averaging 44 and a half attempts per game right now. He's going to have a solid pass blocking advantage in this one. It is a good pass rush by Chicago, but his offensive line is just so damn good. The number one offense, the number three pass blocking unit. So Tom Brady is firmly in play. And as always, like, Mike Evans is a little bit expensive. Antonio Brown's price finally comes up, but Gronk might come back, right? By the time you're watching this, you might know. You get a fair price on Chris Godwin, who's still seeing the volume and he's just not popped off yet. So his ownership should naturally be lower. So I think that Tom Brady would be sort of that next man up who can take the reins as the yes for me. Lamar Jackson, if you want to get there, fine. Price point stays the same. I just prefer other guys. Derek Carr would be like your one punt play if you wanted to find a cheap value play. I wouldn't go below Derek Carr this week in a matchup against Philadelphia with a 26 implied total, averaging 39 attempts per game. You have the Darren Waller, you have Henry Ruggs. You want to take a flyer on Hunter Renfrow, who's been solid in production, or Brian Edwards, who might finally do something. Go for it. Same exact analysis for Jalen Hurts, more of a cash play for me. I don't have any issues with Jalen Hurts in GBPs. It would be Jalen Hurts to Devonta Smith. I think Quez Watkins is a very interesting play this week. No, it's the opposite of what's happening in Arizona. No Zach Ertz means less two tight end sets for the Eagles, more three wide receiver sets, and that would put the slot receiver in Quez Watkins, who also can dominate on the outside as a big play player, Quez Watkins on the field. So there's your quarterbacks. Let's talk about running backs. And before we do, 2 seconds of your time, I'm going to slide into now two props that I've taken this week. So far, this is my favorite prop in the week. We just talked about Matthew Stafford. I have Matthew Stafford projecting out for 315 passing yards. His over-under on Prize Picks, a player prop site, you just take the over-unders. It's very simple. It's 285 and a half. I have him for 30 yards over this number. Hey, 30 yards over this under. All right, so over this over. So that's an easy over for me. And then Deebo Samuel, he's going to get Jimmy G likely to return on Sunday Night Football, which means less rushing attempts for the quarterback like Trey Lance had. The game maybe gets another possession or so. And Deebo Samuel over 63 and a half receiving yards. He's just automatically built into this offense. It's hard to see Deebo Samuel on a primetime game, a star like himself, against Indianapolis and a team that plays usually a softer defensive zone, not seeing 8-9 targets in this game. And we like him after the catch. So Deebo over 63 and a half yards. I have him for about 82 yards. So I take these two overs. I put it in for the prop right there. You go ahead, and this is all that you do if you want to get a free $100 bet. A free bet up to $100. If Matthew Stafford against the Detroit Lions throws for one passing yard, just one passing yard this week, your first bet, and I'm talking to you out there, somebody who's not signed up to Prize Picks, your first bet is free. No matter what, you get a free $100. If you win the bet, if you take Matthew Stafford, if you win the bet, you get an extra $100. If you lose the bet, you get an extra $100 if you bet $100. If you bet 50, the number would be 50. If you bet 20, the number would be 50. It's on your first bet. So try that out. All you have to do is use the code Sal. You type it in, prizepicks.com. Bam, sign up. Bam, you type in your information, 30 seconds. Yeah, got a code? Yeah, Sal. And there you go. And Matthew Stafford throws for 1 yard against his former team. You can cheer, jump up and down, party like you just don't care, like a rock star, because your first bet is now free and a credit matched. So there you go. Take those ones right there. And with that, let's slide into the running back position. We head to the running back position now. Derrick Henry, I don't have as a yes right now. He's a maybe for me. He looks fantastic. He's averaging 29 fantasy points per game. He keeps scoring 3 touchdowns in football games and having over 100 yards. I think he can dominate the Kansas City Chiefs. I have no issues with Derrick Henry. I have him coming in as the highest owned running back at $9,200. So when a guy is the highest owned running back at the highest price point and is not, I would say, as good of a play as the wide receivers who are cheaper than him this week at the upper range, I'm just going to get a little bit away from him. But again, if you want him, there's your disclaimer. A guy that I really like as of right now this week, and I want to see where his final ownership comes in. I only have Aaron Jones coming in for 10% ownership on a 10-game slate because he's expensive. He's $7,500. And the Washington defensive line is decent. And the Packers offensive line is still banged up, but they're supposed to get Elkton Jenkins back. David Bakhtiari is practicing, although I don't expect him to return. But here's the thing. The Packers have a 30 implied team total, and they are borderline 10-point favorites in this game. For Aaron Jones, who continues to be involved not only in the passing game, or not only in the running game, but the receiving game, Aaron Jones is seeing 17.8 opportunities per game. He has 22 red zone attempts, which is behind only Derrick Henry on the slate, his 22 red zone attempts right now. He rarely faces soft boxes. Aaron Rodgers usually audibles to put him in the best situations. So Aaron Jones for me looks like a very good play this week. Aaron Jones for me, if I look at just my value ratings overall, he grades out as a top 4 overall play for me. Looks like a great super draft play as well. And you're not getting as much ownership on him. Now, some some guys, and after you go to Aaron Jones, right, like start to look at the salaries that I have on here as all these yes running backs. If you're watching on YouTube, we'll talk through them on the podcast version. But all of these salaries are what we talked about in the first look lineup on how the 6K range and the upper 5K range looks fantastic. That's what you're getting here, because all you have is the 6K range and the 5K range. There's never any 4K running backs outside of last week, Khalil Herbert. You rarely get that. And if you're not going to Derrick Henry, there's no other 9K or 8K or even 7K running backs this week. So it's a hollowed out running back position. Naturally, you're going to find cheaper running backs. So this is what you get. You get Daryl Henderson and Joe Mixon and Leonard Fournette on here. These are right now three of my top value plays. Three of my top six value running backs. I do love Daryl Henderson because he's in as good of a spot as it gets. We don't have to break it down as much. He's my number one value running back from the values video you can check out that went out earlier in the week, but a 14.5 point favorite against the team that gives up the most points to the running back position. And oh yeah, he has a 32.5 team implied total. The odds that the workhorse running back on the team with that type of a total in game situation, the workhorse running back that is seeing 19.4 opportunities per game and 15 red zone opportunities this year, the odds that guy finds the end zone are pretty damn high. Joe Mixon, there's a little bit of a concern here. I will pause if Joe Mixon starts to pick up massive ownership. He's at average ownership for a 10-game slate of 12% right now, but there was no Samaje Perine last week. Chris Evans was still factored in the air and on the ground, and so is Trevion Williams, a guy who his rookie year he missed because of an ACL injury. Now he's finally getting to get some usage. Those guys were all factored in, and although Joe Mixon saw a big workload, he saw 23 touches, he saw his 5 receptions on 6 targets, if you get Samaje Perine back, if Chris Evans stays involved, does it just go right back to the Joe Mixon 2 targets, 1 catch for 7 yards, and now you're hoping that as an underdog in this game that he can see enough volume on the ground to get him there? Is it right back to the Joe Mixon 18 carries, 75 yards, and even if he scores a touchdown, 13 fantasy points is not that much in GPPs for us to rely on? So I will admit that this yes on Joe Mixon becomes a little bit shakier compared to a Daryl Henderson and even compared to a Leonard Fournette, because Leonard Fournette is not a 6-point underdog. He's a 13-point favorite. He doesn't have a 20 implied team total like Joe Mixon. He has a 30-plus implied team total here, right? Leonard Fournette's opportunities these past couple of weeks have also been fantastic. Obviously, not only on the ground, but they're not just putting him out of the backfield catching these swing passes. He's lining up on the outside, catching 30-yard go routes down the field, wearing number 7, looking like a motherfucking superstar back in his days at LSU. I mean, these are the touch counts for Leonard Fournette over the last couple of games, right? He's coming off of a 28-touchdown game on Thursday night. Thursday night Lenny, he said, right? And then he's coming off of a 16-touch game where he goes for over 100 yards against Miami. And then the game before that, it's a 23-touch game. So if you're looking at this, if you're looking at the opportunities that he's getting in these games as well, I mean, you could basically expect 18 opportunities around 18 to 20 touches. That's very good, especially when you're paired up with Tom Brady. You know they're going to be able to move the ball. Leonard Fournette, for me right now, comes in with 15% ownership. He is going to be, as of this recording, this is going to change. Get the updated projections on Patreon. We now have NBA tools. We have NBA ownership, an NBA optimizer, NBA props, NBA projections updated daily. Check that all out. That's also included in Patreon now. You get so much fucking stuff. We finally got the optimizer and the ownership this year. We're ready to roll. So you get all those tools updated. But Leonard Fournette, my third highest projected owned running back right now, not for me, but by the field, I have him coming in at 15% projected ownership. You can check that out down below on Patreon. I think one of my favorite plays on the week is going to end up being Chuba Hubbard. Chuba Hubbard just looks fantastic. He's coming in with ownership as well, 14% as it stands, but I think that's too low for the price point. You have Chuba Hubbard right now barely cracking the $6,000 range for a running back with no Christian McCaffrey on IR. They have not shown to want to give the ball to anybody else. Rodney Smith, who was active 3 weeks ago when Chuba Hubbard only saw 13 carries and 2 receptions, has not played the last 2 weeks. And now you have Chuba Hubbard coming off of these last 2 games, 30 opportunities and 19 opportunities. In those games, he scored 18.5 and 13.5 fantasy points. 13.5 fantasy points on 18 opportunities is low, right? Especially now in a matchup against the Giants where you're a favorite. They give up top 5 fantasy points to running backs on this slate. So this is a good spot for Chuba Hubbard this week. I currently have Chuba Hubbard projecting out for about 15 fantasy points. That makes him probably about $600 to $700 under price based on what my model, quote unquote, has. Next up is DeAndre Swift. DeAndre Swift's role is just insane. It's like 90% of his production this year, both touchdowns and also, and this is also true because it's skewed because Detroit has just been trailing in like all of their games, especially the second half, but 90% of his production, his fantasy points, have been coming when they're trailing. 90% of his receptions when they're trailing. All of his touchdowns basically have been coming, outside of one, when they're trailing. It's insane. It is rinse and repeat. We said it, I think, on this show last week. What do they have to do? They'll get down, he'll have 5 catches, he'll score a late touchdown. What happens? They get down, it's the fourth quarter, he's got no fantasy points. He catches 3 balls. He now has 40 yards. He has a 7-yard run, and then he gets a 1-yard rushing touchdown. And just like that, DeAndre Swift goes from having 5 fantasy points for you to 17 fantasy points for you like that. Like that. It's absolutely unreal, this guy's role. It's a terrible fucking role that relies on his team sucking and his quarterback just checking down to him. And it's just happening. So eventually that's going to run out. So like Joe Mixon here, the guys like DeAndre Swift make me a little bit concerned. The problem is DeAndre Swift is facing the Rams, who we want to play a lot of this week. So whether it's skinny stacks with Darrell Henderson, whether it's game stacks with his quarterback, Matt Stafford. So that's going to be one of the best run back options is Swift, who does grade out as a solid play. But again, I would prefer guys who are in that same price range like a Chuba Hubbard and even guys who are potentially cheaper like a Darrell Williams. Darrell Williams is a great play. He is potentially a smash play. Last week, people are saying, you didn't want to play Darrell Williams, and now you do. I didn't want to play Darrell Williams last week because Khalil Herbert was cheaper in a better role. And what did he do? Khalil Herbert was 3 yards short of the rushing bonus, had some receptions, had a touchdown, looked good. Did he score 2 touchdowns like Darrell Williams? No, we can't project who is going to score the 2 touchdown games unless you're just going to tell me it's Derrick Henry. Well, then, yeah, okay, maybe he does. But even though I'm saying Darrell Williams is a smash play, a great play, is a 5-point favorite with a 30.5 implied total attached to Patrick Mahomes versus this Tennessee defense right now. That ranks 25th versus the run, 29th in tackling per my matchup notes, and it has a positive 62% advantage according to Pro Football Focus for Darrell Williams. Even though all those things remain true, you're not going to get the passing game roll out of Darrell Williams. You got all the snaps and all the usage out of him compared to like what Clyde Edwards-Helaire was seeing, but Jerick McKinnon is still out there. Elijah McGuire was active. We'll see if he actually starts to see some usage, but it's really tough to rely on this. You had 3 catches, 89 total yards, and 2 touchdowns. If he's now a higher price point of $5,800, if you have Darrell Williams in this game having 2 catches for a total of 70 yards and only 1 touchdown, is that enough? Is 14 or 15 fantasy points enough for you? It's definitely not hurting your lineup. So that's why this price point is still fair. It's more so the game environment. I'm not relying on this guy catching a ton of passes, but he did go out there and play 71% of the snaps, run 21 routes in this game after running 24 the week before. So although the historical trends of Darrell Williams aren't great in this offense and running backs in general, the fact that the running backs in this offense do score touchdowns, that at least gives me some confidence. Next up, one of the better GPP plays grading out for me as my number 3 overall value is Chase Edmonds. It's mainly because they're 15 point favorites with a high team total. Chase Edmonds is also seeing all of the passing game work in this backfield, as you have James Conner seeing less than 1 target per game to Edmonds seeing closer to 5 targets per game. So that's a riskier play. Wouldn't do it in cash, wouldn't do it in small field single entries, but in some mid to larger field single entry stuff and GPPs, he starts to look like a lot better of a play because over the last 2 weeks, you're only getting 8 and 4 fantasy points. But if you look at the weeks before that, 18, 14 and a half, 12 and a half, and 14 and a half. So I'm projecting him for closer to those outcomes, and especially in an environment where I don't think he only plays 38% of the snaps like last week, where they get up massive in a game that I think stays maybe not closer because this is a 15-point favorite. I'm not going to project a 25 to 30-point difference like last week was when the entire Cleveland Browns team ended up getting hurt. And then the final interest of mine, Devontae Booker would be my final yes. Devontae Booker's role is just great. I mean, there's not going to be a Saquon, or at least Saquon has not been practicing this week. So if Saquon Barkley is indeed out, you're getting a fantastic role here out of Devontae Booker. Devontae Booker over the past week and a half to 2 weeks with no Saquon Barkley has been the workhorse. He had 90% of the snaps and then 70% of the snaps last week. And last week, he ended up running 32 routes, right? He ended up catching 4 passes. He's now had 8 targets in the last 2 games. So there's a nice role here for the price point. That is where I'm at mainly on the running back position. With that being said, now let's move over to the most important position most weeks, and including this week, the wide receiver position, a loaded position even on a 10-game 20-team slate. Before we do that, like button is somewhere up here, right up in here. Hit that like button. What are you doing? What do you say? Hit that like button as well. So the wide receiver position, to the top of it, the studs. We don't have to spend much time here. Devontae Adams stacked up on Aaron Rodgers. If you don't want to go with Devontae Adams stacked up on Aaron Rodgers, I would actually prefer, if you had to choose one of these studs, I do still prefer Devontae Adams over Kupp and Tyreek Hill. Tyreek Hill is very close. I expect to maybe get, if I don't have Mahomes as my number one quarterback, it'll be Stafford. So these next wide receivers are probably going to be some of my highest owned just because of the fact that they get in there and as solo plays without stacks, and they'll definitely get in there as stacks. So Tyreek Hill and Cooper Kupp, we don't have to overthink this week. Those guys look great. Those guys have 32 implied totals. Those guys look fantastic. These are the projections for me. Devontae Adams, 24.2 points at 18% ownership. We're giving away some of the goods here, so open up those earballs, will you? Cooper Kupp, 23 fantasy points at 20% ownership. Tyreek Hill, 23.2 at 16% ownership. So they're all coming in right around 23 to 24 fantasy points, all right around 18% ownership. So there's not much difference in these guys as of right now. That can change. The main difference would be you get a little bit of a bonus from correlation if you're stacking them up with their quarterback, of course. And now we start to get to some more of the interesting plays, if you will. I have a lot of interest in Calvin Ridley, who is coming in with 10 to 12% ownership, but it's a $6,600 Calvin Ridley, a guy that you would not have been shocked and won't be shocked in 3 weeks if you're paying $8,000 for, right? So you're still getting 10.5 targets per game. We haven't seen him in a while. He had the bye week. He didn't play in the London game when Kyle Pitts and Cordell Patterson went off. So I do think naturally there'll be a little bit less ownership on him. And I'm completely completely fine getting to Calvin Ridley, a man who so far this week I have projecting out right now for about 17 fantasy points. And at his price point, that means that he should probably be like a $7,200 to $7,400 wide receiver. So I like Calvin Ridley a lot this week. Matchup against Miami, who right now is giving up the third most points to wide receivers on this slate. You have AJ Brown, who's just a natural run back, especially if Julio Jones doesn't start to go. AJ Brown in the second half really popped off on Monday Night Football in that matchup against the Bills. Now, this is a good spot for AJ Brown. And there's been all these injuries. AJ Brown has been banged up left and right, nonstop these injuries for AJ Brown. And then it comes out that in the first half of the last game, he was battling Chipotle and potentially having to go to the bathroom. So he couldn't run down the field, which explains why he didn't have like any receptions. And now AJ Brown is going to get a matchup against this Chiefs secondary. A matchup against this Chiefs secondary that, if I pull up my lovely matchup notes here, is going to tell me that this is one of the best spots for any wide receiver. And oh yeah, AJ Brown is closer to $5,000 and $7,000 this week at just $6,300. Matchups against Mike Hughes. He's going to give up about a 37-pound advantage he has on Mike Hughes and basically 35-plus pounds on most of these cornerbacks and most of the cornerbacks in the NFL. AJ Brown is going to look like a solid option this week. Projects out for me for a little over 16 fantasy points. I have him as a $7,200 wide receiver who's priced at $6,300, currently coming in with 12% ownership. Just a solid play all around. Next up for me is Chris Godwin, who I do think if you're playing these Tampa Bay stacks, that Chris Godwin is definitely one way to get different. If Gronk returns, that's another way. Mike Evans' price point is up. I would expect that Antonio Brown comes in as the highest owned guy in this wide receiver court, $6,300, and the guy was producing the most. But Chris Godwin is still somebody at this price point at $5,900 now that I'm completely fine playing, right? He's coming off of a game where he only saw 9 fantasy points on 5 targets in that Thursday night game. But that was a game where it was kind of the Leonard Fournette show. They didn't really have to pass the ball that much. He was getting involved early, often on. His snap count came back up to 92% after dropping to 75% against Miami. But if you're looking at this now, he's had 9, 14, and 8.5 fantasy points over the last 3 games. That's not great. But if you want to just look at 3-game samples, then don't just close yourself off to the first 3 games or the last 3 games, because the first 3 games, it was 24, 16, and 20 fantasy points, right? So we can't change things on how we look at this. He didn't get injured, right? He's had this weird stretch of where his team has gone a little bit more run heavy, even though they're still throwing touchdowns. They've gone a little bit more run heavy. Leonard Fournette having 20 plus carries in 2 out of the last 3 games, but he's still seeing the same snaps, 90%+. He's still running the same routes, 39, 34, and 36 over this time. He's averaging 7 targets per game these last 3 games instead of 8 targets per game that he was averaging the first 3. This is still a very similar role for Chris Godwin. He's just basically not finding the end zone. He hasn't had a touchdown in these last 3 games, right? So if he finds the end zone in any of these games, he has you 17. He has you 20. He has you 17 fantasy points. So Chris Godwin, the amount that Tom Brady is throwing 44 times a game, leading the NFL in red zone attempts, is eventually going to come back to him in a positive way. Sterling Shepard looks like a strong cash game play. Sterling Shepard looks like somebody who might end up being the highest on wide receiver by the end of the week. He looks fantastic. Is expected to be no Kadarius Toney. Saquon and Kenny Galladay right now are not practicing. In games where Sterling Shepard has started and finished, he has 9, 10, and 14 targets and 24, 18, and 18 fantasy points. Just looks like a really strong play for Daniel Jones this week. Jacoby Myers, I'll keep going back to Jacoby Myers. Jacoby Myers, a lot of people are going to look at last week's performance and say, against the Cowboys, he couldn't get it done then, which is actually a more difficult matchup than you think. But then you look at it a little bit closer, and it wasn't that bad of a performance for Jacoby Myers. And now he gets a matchup against the Jets, but it wasn't that bad of a performance. 11.4 fantasy points on 6 targets, but he had a touchdown call back. If he finally get his first touchdown in his career last week, it's 17 points. So a yes might be a little bit high here, especially in the matchup against the Jets if these teams play at a very slow pace and run the ball a ton. So let's make him a maybe. A guy that I do like if he returns. I don't know how Devontae Parker, and we'll see what happens with Will Fuller status if he's ever going to return. I have no idea how Devontae Parker is only $5,000. I mean, this is a 6'3", 210-pound alpha X receiver on the outside is only going to be $5,000 with Tua back, so it means the offense will move a little bit better, right? This is a guy who in games where he's actually played this year has 12, 10, 8, and 17.7 fantasy points. Now, obviously, Tua has not played in all those games, but he's running the routes. He's ran 26, 43, 42, and 32 routes this year, seeing 7 targets in at least every single one of his games. If you're going to get the average that he's seen this year of 8 targets per game out of Devontae Parker in a matchup against Atlanta, where they are underdogs and Tua might have to throw close to 40 times like he did in that last game, Parker looks great. I'll keep going back to the well with T. Higgins because his price point remains low. In a matchup against Baltimore, it is a better matchup than people expect here. The problem is that Joe Mixon just came back and rushed the ball 18 times and that they had backup running backs rushing the ball in that game 10 times. So do they just go right back to running the ball nonstop? Because Higgins in his last 2 games has only seen 13 total targets and 8 total receptions. So maybe like Jacoby Myers, as I talk through this out loud to myself into the camera in front of me like a psychopath. Hey, it's my job. We're just talking to ourselves in cameras. That's what we do here. But if you reply in the comments and make me feel like I'm actually having a conversation with people, maybe we don't feel as crazy. But maybe T. Higgins I'm a little bit too high on. I think these are nice GPP options down here. These are other guys that a yes is maybe a little bit too high. But the matchup against the Bucks this week. If you're running back your stacks this week, obviously Allen Robinson is a strong run back option. The problem is the Bears are not fucking throwing the ball. But Darnell Mooney is the one guy who can be the quick strike play for you, right? You saw that earlier this year. You saw that earlier this year in week 4. 7 targets, 5 catches, 125 yards. And Mooney honestly seems to be the favorite target of Justin Fields. 8 targets last week, went to him in the red zone, ended up having the touchdown. The problem is the Bears just don't throw the ball. And if you're only going to get, and now Tampa Bay is going to force him to throw the ball more, but we can't just automatically assume that that's what's going to happen when a team has shown they don't want to throw the ball. When a team so far this year, if you're looking at just the overall attempts out of Justin Fields, 27, 20, 17, 20, 13. I mean, this is absolutely brutal. 13's a game where he came in a little bit later on, but if you're only going to be able to get a career high and a season high, 27 attempts in that last game. Maybe if they trail for most of this game, you get Justin Fields throwing for 35, 37, 40 times. And that's where Darnell Mooney and Allen Robinson start to become a little bit more secure. Rashad Bateman at $3,400 led the wide receivers and tied for the team high in targets last week. He's not running deep down the field. It's more so these chain moving plays. So if you get like 6 targets, 5 catches for 40 yards, it's probably your outcome if he doesn't find the end zone. That's just more of a salary saver if you really need it, if you're not going cheap at tight end. Other than that, bunch of wide receivers in play. Robbie Anderson continues to see production. Rondell Moore, I want to play. He's more of a play on Super Draft with a 1.9x multiplier, but the fact is Zach Ertz is there is less 4 wide receiver sets. DJ Moore is going to be lower owned because, one, the price point's dropping, but he's going to be lower owned because of the last 2 weeks of non-production. Sam Darnold struggling. The fact that all these weapons are now out, the offensive line's banged up, no Terrace Marshall, you don't have any more out there. Christian McCaffrey and some other weapons that are banged up, Robbie Anderson dropping balls, so the offense overall is stalling, and that's hurting DJ Moore. Terry McLaurin, I want to play Terry McLaurin. Terry McLaurin is one of my favorite GPP runbacks. If you want to go just a skinny stack with Adams and Terry McLaurin, it's great. The problem is Terry McLaurin clearly looks hurt. Like, the hamstring injury came up in the middle of the week last week. I wish I would have taken that more seriously as a wide receiver with a hamstring injury. But I'm going to track the news this week and see what happens there. Mike Evans is probably going to come in lower owned, so he's a fine play. You get Robert Woods, you get Robbie Anderson, or you get Antonio Brown. All these guys are fine options. Devonta Smith, I really like in GPPs. Like, Devonta Smith skinny stacked with a Darren Waller, Devonta Smith skinny stacked with a Henry Ruggs looks like a great large field GPP run. Whole lot of value plays. Nico Collins returned last week, and you have now Chris Conley dealing with injury, so the rookie should see some use out there as a run back option for Arizona if you didn't want to go to Brandon Cooks. I actually think he's in play. Tajay Sharpe remains in play if there's no Russell Gage, but also no Calvin Ridley, which I'm not expecting for Atlanta as he kind of ran ahead of Ole Miss in that London game before the bye. Let's finish up the final thoughts. Week 7 with you hitting the subscribe button, bada bing, bada bang, and the tight end position, which is going to be, you know, not straightforward. There's a lot of really good plays because the pricing is fantastic. Like Darren Waller, I'm getting tired of getting burned by him, but so is everybody else. This is strictly a GPP play here. Darren Waller skinny stacked with a Devonta Smith or Devonta Smith, like we just said, or just a one-off in his own right is naturally going to get you different this week because you're going to get Darren Waller coming in this week with probably 6-8% ownership, even though he's the cheapest that we've seen him in a while. But it makes sense. It makes sense because you're just not getting the production. After his 26.5 fantasy points week 1, he has yet to go over 11.5 fantasy points. He has yet to see in a game over 5 receptions after having 10 in week 1. That's a concern. Now, he has had red zone targets in every single game though, so that's where the upside comes in. My favorite tight end play this week right now is these next probably two guys. It's Kyle Pitts number 1. With Calvin Ridley coming back, we do have to temper expectations for the massive 100 plus yard and a touchdown game that Kyle Pitts had, but you can still expect him to run 70-80% of the time in the slot or out wide as a wide receiver. I have him for 15 fantasy points. I have him as the second highest owned tight end right now behind Kelsey. Dallas Goedert. Here's the nice thing about Dallas Goedert. He's now never going to leave the field. Dallas Goedert, there was a concern on his snap counts, right? Because Dallas Goedert in 3 wide receiver sets sometimes left the field for Zach Ertz. He's not going to leave the field now for Jack Stoll. So if you want to look at Dallas Goedert's snap counts, 66, 63, 55, 73, and 61, which meant his routes sometimes were terrible. 14 routes, 10 routes, 17 routes, 34 routes, very good against Kansas City when they're trailing, and then 17 routes. Now you might actually see a full-time role here. You might see an 80 to 90% snap role as a guy who is a good blocker, and there's no Zach Ertz to pull in a lot of his routes and snaps. So if we start getting double the routes run that we were seeing every game out of Zach Ertz, instead of 14, it's 24, 28. Instead of 10, it's 24, right? In these types of game environments, especially in a game here where they're underdogs, it could be a very nice spot for Dallas Goedert. Other than that, Tyler Higbee's more so in play in stacks. Tyler Higbee, I don't think we can say is a secure play for his target volume. Does he have red zone upside for an offense that's throwing the ball everywhere across the field? Yes, of course. But if you're saying that a secure play to play as a one-off, I'd much rather have Dallas Goedert for a similar price range or go down to some other plays because the target volume is just not there, right? I mean, he has a season high of just 6 targets, a season high of just 5 receptions. The last 2 games combined, he's seen just 7 targets. So it's really hard to trust him as a standout play. He's on a yes here just because he's going to be involved in a lot of my stacks. And then Ricky Seals-Jones leads the NFL in routes run at the tight end position the last 2 weeks. There is still no Logan Thomas as he's on IR. I have Ricky Seals-Jones projecting out as a solid play, a really good play. This is another way to skinny stack it. If you want to play Davante Adams and skinny stack it without a quarterback back with Ricky Seals-Jones, I don't see why not. Looks good on Superdraft. Ricky Seals-Jones in his last 2 games has 36 and 34 routes, and he has a combined 9 receptions for about 99 yards and a touchdown. So the price point is coming up, but still he's in the 3K range. He's probably the best punt tight end. If you're looking for other punt tight ends on here, like other guys who are in play, obviously Kelsey's been playing stacks. Mark Andrews has been playing some of the best football over his last 2 game stretch, probably the best 2 game stretch in his career, since you factor in a career game in there. He looks fine. Hockenson, run back option. Mike Gesicki with some other guys probably coming back, like a Devontae Parker. We'll see what happens with Will Fuller. Not as much of a priority, but Tua clearly likes him. And then 2 punt plays at 2,500. I'm personally not going to go here all that much, but Durham Smythe, he's not going to look as good with Devontae Parker coming back. Probably less 2 tight end sets, but still not a terrible option, as he's going to see 4 or 5 targets as a tight end. And then Ryan Griffin ran a ton of routes. Ryan Griffin was not productive, and this was with Tyler Kroft out. We'll see if this holds up, but I think Ryan Griffin might just actually be the tight end one on this Jets team. Ryan Griffin went out there in their last game, the game before the bye when you were in London, and he ended up seeing 26 routes run, which was a season high by a good amount. That only led to 1 catch for 4 yards. The indicating stats here, like the routes run. Again, I'm probably not playing these tight ends. So there you go. There's your schmacks for the day. Thank you. Thank you, beautiful people, for tuning in today. Now, go ahead and get, if Matt Stafford throws for 1 passing yard, you get the free bet up to $100 on prizepicks.com using the code SAL. Your first bet is matched for free right away as a credit up to $100. Thank you for tuning in. Before you go, subscribe button. Let me know in the comment section this week, who is your favorite wide receiver play in the entire slate? Taking out price, ownership, your favorite play, the guy you're playing at the wide receiver position. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'll see you in the Patreon Discord. If you're not a Patreon member, get up in there, especially with the NBA starting right now. We have every single possible thing you need for the NBA at 50 to 100% less than anywhere else in the industry, because I'm just a one-man band and I don't got to charge the highest prices because I don't got to play employees and all this other stuff, which is the nice thing about being the one-man band. There's some stressful parts, there's some hard working parts, but that's the nice thing in here. We can make the barrier of entry for other people, some beautiful people like you, to join this community, get in the Discord, push it over 1,000 people. We can make it very simple. So thank you so much. I'll see you on the next one. That One Dude coming out on Saturday. Sunday live stream, and then Monday we start it all back up again. I'll see you when I see you, gang. I'll see you in the next one.